right on time, as far as I'm not concerned. All right, good to have you here this morning. God bless you. If you're a guest or a visitor, thank you for being with us today. I saw some new faces already, and some folks are here visiting who are away. I saw Jack and Margaret. God bless you. Welcome back as well. And let me make just a number of announcements this morning that we want you to be aware of. And again, if you're watching the wall or the... Yvonne, welcome home, too. I just saw you. God bless you. Watch the wall or the TV in the back. The announcements are actually playing, so you can see them to cut our time with announcements up. Hey, brother, there's seats right in the front. There's great seats right in the front. God bless you. Your family's here, but they're in the back somewhere. All right. So remember, it's good to be early. There's benefits to it. And then there's punishment for this. All right? No, not, you can come up here if you want to. It's fine. Okay, enough of the nonsense. This morning, you'll see our birthday and anniversary bank. This will be happening every time we do communion. If you have a birthday anniversary, in the past, we've taken some time, and whatever your age is, like 105, you put some money in there for that. And what happens is, and when we have a missionary family come in, all of that goes to their children, and that's been a tremendous blessing for the kids of our missionaries. And so if you have a birthday anniversary this month, the month of August, if you can do that, we'll make sure that they get that. So speaking of anniversaries and birthdays, I know there's a lot going on, but this morning, Tom and Beth are celebrating 45 years of marriage. God bless you. What's the secret, Beth? Be quick to admit when you're wrong and be wrong a lot. Okay, so 45 years, that's what I would look for, all right? And then just this, I don't know, but Stan's Flowers just won the Florist Shop of the Year 2020. And you should know that Katie and Tracy are a big part of that, almost all of it, so God bless you. Moving right along. Okay, if you're a member of our church, and you're a halfway friendly person, which you all should be on Sundays and every day, I need 10 people after service today to say, hey, I am willing on a schedule, like once every 10 weeks, to at least stand in the back and find seats for people. Right? You don't have to have a master's degree. You don't even have to have an IQ very high. All you have to know is where there are empty seats at, and say, I'm willing to be friendly when people come in and direct them to a seat. So if you're a member of our church and you could do that once every 10 weeks, see me afterwards or see Mel McDonald is probably better. See Mel McDonald. Mel, wave to us. There you go. All right.
There's a sign-up sheet on the welcome desk.
Oh, she says, don't see me. There's a sign-up sheet on the welcome desk. All right? But really, 10 people, this should not be a problem. I expect to have 20 by the end of this. So if I have two, I'll be really mad. Online prayer is continuing. We've made that a priority here. We'll talk more about prayer in just a moment. Our online prayer on Tuesday, our gathering on Thursday at 9:30. There is a youth and young adults activity, the Amazing Race, on August 12th from 6:30 to 10. If you're part of that, make sure you're there for that. The Mary and Martha group meets on the 16th of August at 7:30. That's a time change that they've been doing. Just be aware of that. And then the ladies' retreat. We've had a great response so far, like a really good response, but today is the day that you have to pay for it. And let me encourage you, because Kim has, he's paid for everyone who signed up from our savings account. So, you need to pay, or she will be in debtor's prison, because, okay, so you can pay, you can see her, we have a, you can e-transfer it, and she'll take care of that, so see Kim. I think there's like over 60, there's 40 women? Plus other churches, right. So a good turnout, it should be a great time. Be still and be loved, September 23rd and 24th. If you need more information, please see her. And then just real quick, we have been doing a campaign, and I know I'm going fast, I'm just trying to get this done, but I know it has to be done. We've been doing a campaign in our church to leave it better. And the idea is when you see a mess in the church, you just clean it up and help, because we have volunteers who do an awesome job cleaning this place. I've noticed over the last several weeks, it's getting better. Actually, wonderfully better. It hasn't even right, but it's getting better. And there was a young family in here last week, and they were in the gymnasium. I was in my office. I looked out of my office. The gymnasium was trashed. There were balls everywhere. There was stuff everywhere. And I'm thinking, oh. So I went back to my office. I came out when they left, and not only was the gymnasium completely cleaned, there were other things that weren't cleaned that they cleaned up. So that's the culture that we're trying to produce here, and we should. So good job to the families who are working hard. Keep up the good work. And then the lost and found is growing again. So if you're leaving church without your shoes on, you should look in there. There's coats, there's jackets, there's dishes, and they can't stay in there forever. The lost and found is the first room, I think, as you exit the building on your right-hand side. So take care of that. Sunday night growth group is canceled this evening, and so there's no growth group this evening. Carlene, there's more seats up here, sister. All right, she stopped. So no growth group tonight. It's canceled this evening. Be aware of that. And then something new that will happen today that will happen from here on out. At the end of the service, years and years ago, we did an altar call, an invitation. We sort of moved away from that, and for various reasons, not good or bad, it is what it is. But we've realized that after a service, or at the last song of a service, there are people who really want to come and pray, and God is dealing with them. Or they want to pray with somebody about a certain need. And so starting today, at the last song, there will be men and women at the front, some of our elders, deacons, some of our godly ladies who are always praying. And if you feel the need to come forward and you want to pray by yourself, you can. You can find a seat in the front. Or we used to kneel down by the stairs, actually. I want to normalize this because there's something beautiful and powerful about a community that's honest and open about our brokenness and our need of grace. You don't have to pray with somebody. You're welcome to. But someone will be available for the last song and after the service if you want to pray with somebody. And the people who are doing this are people who love our church family, who love the Lord. And it's another connection point. And I want it to be a regular pattern of our church. So we'll begin that today. So if you see people up in the front and you feel a need, like you want to pray, if something special in your life is happening, or just pray by yourself, that's available for you. So please take advantage of that, and you will see that, Lord willing, from here on out. So thank you for that. Quickly this morning, the request, I saw Ian and Judy been doing a fantastic job of being here. Doris is here, and I just saw Daniel walk in with the boys, I think. God bless you guys. And is it, I want to say Abby, but that's not, it's not, wait, hold on. It's Hope. Hope is better. Abby's a great name, but Hope is a good name too. All right, so good to have you guys with us this morning. But pray for Kathy. The stem cell is coming up quickly. Hopefully, Lord willing, in August, yes? This week. All right, so pray for them. They've had quite the battle and journey. It's so good to see them here today. Pray for Kathy. And then pray for Grandma Tutty, Jean Tutty. She had a mild heart attack. I think she's home now, as far as I know, with her son John, so pray for her. Pray for Bob Wood. Bob has surgery on Tuesday for a hip replacement, so pray for Bob, if you would. Again, Brother Olson, as they look for just treatment for him. And then Alyssa Grant. Alyssa is a young lady in our church, cancer. She goes this Wednesday for a massive dose of radiation up in London. And we're praying that the radiation, of course, eradicates the cancer. And then for her vocal cords, they need to be rejuvenated. She's with a trach right now. Sweetest spirit you would ever find in a young lady. Hopeful, cheerful. I prayed with the family last week, and they're just a blessing to be around. But pray for that this Wednesday, the 10th. Of course, continue to pray for Kristen, Paul and Debbie's daughter. She's had a number of surgeries right now, and I think the main thing they're worried about is an infection. So pray for her that this infection will heal up. There's some seats overseas. We need 10 people after the service. Alyssa, God bless you. You're a good lady. All the kids, wonderful. So pray for Kristen. She's still in the hospital. Might be another week or so, but she's progressing, we think, and continue to pray for her, especially the infection. And then pray for Roger and Roxanne. We gave the loop out that Roger was given 4 to 6 months of life. The cancer is spread into both of his lungs, his lymph nodes. So pray for them. They're in Windsor right now with their family. And just pray for grace and strength for them, if you would. I think I got Greg. After church, young adults meeting. Oh, young adults, there's a little meeting for you afterwards. Young adults are between the ages of 18 to about 30 or so. There's a little get together for you to meet and to know other young adults. Are you going to meet in the right off the kitchen. They've got some drinks and some food or some snacks there. So even if you're here for the first time, or you've been here just once or twice, go and see some other young people. We actually have one or two here. So it'd be a good idea. And right afterwards, young adult, make your way there, and it'll be a great time. Friends and guests, thank you for being here today. So many new faces. Yes?
Just about Roger and Roxanne.
Yeah. 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 So they're not in town. They're in Windsor.
But you can talk to her. She's happy to get home.
Yeah. Yeah. So if you're going to pay them a visit, you won't be there in Windsor with her daughter, Michelle. So if you want to talk to her, please do that. And I guess when it settles down, they'd be more than happy to see you. But you got to coordinate that with them. Thank you, Rick. Anything else? I saw another hand maybe. And this is a note. This is from our neighbors. Our family was so good. Their church family caring for them. To Maple City Baptist Church, we're extremely grateful for your kindness and generosity towards our family. May God bless each and every one of you from the Hildebrandt family. Thank you for your kindness to them. They're still not in a home yet. They're waiting for another trailer to come, but thank you for your kindness to them. Okay, I am done talking for at least 15 minutes. All right, Brother Tom, would you lead us in prayer? Read the word, lead us in prayer, and then we'll corporately sing. Thank you, brother. Yep.
We're going to be reading from the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 11. We're going to be starting to read it, verses 23 to 26 in your Bibles, okay? 1 Corinthians, chapter 11. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, today we come together to acknowledge the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ that he made on our behalf. As we prepare our hearts for the Lord's table, help us to think soberly and rightly, examining our lives from your holy perspective and through the eyes of those who intimately know our ways. Father, would you search our hearts and see if there's any wicked ways in us? Would you make us aware of our complacency, the neglect of our devotion and discipline in our lives towards you? Would you remind us of the times we refused to take the way of escape when we were tempted? Oh, Father, forgive us and cleanse us of all righteousness. For we pray this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
If you could all join us in standing as we sing praises and worship the King, the one who died for us.
Seated at your table, Jesus, thank you. has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. What's your enemy? Now seated at your table, Jesus, thank you. What's your enemy? Now seated at your table, Jesus, thank you.
It is good to give thanks to the Lord and to sing praises to your name, O Most High, to declare your loving kindness in the morning and your faithfulness every night.
To him, today salvation has come to this house, because he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost.
He has
Father, thank you for this morning. Lord, we thank you for what we've heard already through the reading of your word, through the singing of the hymns. And now, Lord, we look forward to looking at the preaching of your word. Lord, we've gathered together this day to focus on the Lord's Supper. And our prayer is that through everything that's said and done, Jesus Christ would be exalted and lifted high, and that men and women would be drawn to him, and we as believers, our hearts would be full this morning of the gracious sacrifice of our Jesus. We ask this all in his name. Amen. You may be seated. At our church, for those of us who attend here, we understand this morning, I hope you understand, that it is the Word of God, the power of the Spirit of God, that changes the people of God for the glory of God. And so, the Word of God is what we focus on. And it's imperative for us not to put something there, but to bring out what is in the text. It's not what we want to be there, but what it is there. It's not what suits us or rubs us the right way, but what it says. And it is certainly not what our woke culture endorses. It is our obligation this morning to preach the Word of God, to preach it. We believe this morning that the Word of God is all sufficient, that what we need for godliness and living and making it in this world comes from the Word of God. Listen this morning what the Word says about itself. Psalm 119:105, your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. The word is a lamp that illuminates our life on what to do next, how to respond, how to act. Proverbs 4, just jump down to verse 22. It tells us that the word is medicine that heals. For those who are brokenhearted, for those who are weary, worn, and tired, for those who are struggling, it is the word of God that is the medicine for our soul to bring healing. Jeremiah 23:29. Is not my word like fire? It is the word of God that consumes. It is the word of God that purifies the life of the believer. He continues in Jeremiah and says, Is it not like a hammer that breaks in pieces? It's been amazing to watch the word of God hit someone's life where it breaks them. It crushes them to heal them and to bring them life. Jesus made it clear in Matthew 4:4, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. The word is food that nourishes us. And without it, we are weak and emaciated people. And then finally, Isaiah 55:10-11. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I promised, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. It is the word of God, like rain and snow, that causes growth in our life. 2 weeks ago, I had the privilege to be with one of our missionaries, Pastor Eves, his wife Naomi, and their son Evno, and to enjoy services with them. Services in the DR by Haitians are different than services here. Pastor Eve said when he was here years ago, I like hot worship. And he likes hot worship, right? And it's a beautiful thing. The service on Sunday started at 8 o'clock with Sunday school and went right into the main service, and we ended at about 12:40. So no complaining today. And the music was glorious. It was glorious. It's that mix of, it's African in nature, it's a Haitian church. It was glorious. I didn't understand hardly anything that was sung, but I understood the spirit. And it was glorious. I knew it was exalting Christ. It was drawing attention to him. And so I understand that worship in music is great. It's great. But worship in the Word is growth. Because the Word is what will sustain us tomorrow morning as we face challenges in our life. And so, I want the Word to speak this morning. We're going to look at the text that Brother Tom read, and we're just going to bring out what is there as we focus in on the Lord's table this morning. Everything today is directed to one thing. It's the table. It's the bread and the cup. And already, by what we heard from the reading, we know instinctively, for us who are believers who have been here, this is about remembering. Remembering. It's remembering Jesus Christ and what he has done. And it is the Lord in his kindness and his understanding of human nature that gives us this ordinance, because he knows that we are prone to be ungrateful even for the greatest and richest mercies that he bestows. This morning we want to remember. We want Christ to be a guest here that we feel and experience and know. There's a quote that I found from Bernard. He was probably the last church father around the 12th century. He said this, "If we wish to have Christ for a guest often," now think about that, "believer, do we not wish in our lives, in our gatherings, that Christ is a guest often, that we sense and we know that we have a fellowship and a friendship with him? If we wish to have Christ for a guest often, we must keep our hearts fortified by the testimony of our faith." And then he continues. This is what he means by fortifying our hearts, by Christ being a guest often, to sense who he is and what he's doing. He says, "Christ died for our sins and rose again from the dead for our justification. He ascended to heaven for our protection, sent the Spirit for our consolation, and will someday return for our fulfillment." And so what he says there is, if I in my life want to sense that presence of Christ, that nearness, his guest in my life often, I must constantly go back to the gospel. And what we do this morning in these elements is this. We once again clearly see the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so this morning, as we've gathered, I want us to put every other distraction out of our minds. Whatever your plans are later on, it does not matter. What matters now is that we remember. We remember. And so I want to give you this morning the procedure on how we got to this ordinance. I want to give you the point of that procedure. And then finally, I want to talk about a word. The word is propitiation. It's not found in the text, but everything we do points to it this morning. So, the procedure. In our text this morning, I'll just read once again the first part, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. "For I have received from the Lord that which also I delivered to you." Paul doesn't make this up. This is from Jesus himself. Jesus said, "Paul, I want you to deliver this to the church." He says that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. So Paul starts off with, why are we here? We're here because on the night that Jesus was betrayed, so it takes us right back to the Gospels. What happened on that night? It was an amazing thing. We know the rest of the story, but those disciples had no idea. They should have, but they had no idea what was coming. And Jesus says to them, "I have longed for, I'm looking forward to this
meal tonight. And he says that, completely understanding that within hours, he would be betrayed. Within hours, he'd go through a mock trial. Within hours, he'd be beaten and scourged and crucified. And yet he says, I've been looking forward to this meal. The meal was the Passover. And we need to understand in our Gentile minds this morning, this is to this point, this is the greatest event in redemptive history, the Passover. It was in that night, the children of Israel who were slaves and in bondage, they took a lamb and they shed the blood of that lamb and they took the blood and put it on their doorpost at the top and on the sides. They ate the meal and they huddled and waited because God said, tonight I will give deliverance. Tonight, I will give freedom. Tonight, you will no longer be slaves. And in an evening, a nation was born. And if you know the story, the destroying angel came through, and everyone who was not covered by the blood, firstborn, was lost. And so they gather together. They're at the Lord, the Passover, and Jesus says, I'm longing to have this with you. They understand the importance of this event, and then Jesus does something that blows their mind. It's a seismic shift in their thinking because he says, okay, we know the Passover. We know the greatness of it, and I want you to know this. Everything we've been celebrating for thousands of years now, all of it points to me. All of it. He takes the greatest event of redemptive history and says, it is all about me. And in the Jewish mind, this is it's unbelievable that he would do this, but that's exactly what he does. And then he takes the bread, and he holds it, and he says, this bread is my body. We got to think through bread a little bit, right? We get bread by crushing the grain. Just pound it out. It's kneaded out. It's worked out. Bread is the staff of life. And Jesus says, my body is this bread. It will be broken for you. And they're sitting there, and he takes the loaf, and he breaks it. And what he said he meant, on that evening, his body would be broken. Broken. He would be bound. He'd be taken to a mock trial. He would be humiliated. He'd be scoffed and laughed at. He'd be spit upon. He'd be smacked in the face. His beard would be plucked from his chin. They would continue. They take a rod and beat him in the head. They take a crown of thorns and crush it into his skull. They would scourge him so where his back was ripped to shreds. Oftentimes in a Roman scourging, the internal organs would be shown. Naked, humiliated, sent to a cross, his hands and his feet pierced, and eventually his side being pierced with a spear. This bread is my body, which is broken for you. And then the cup. This cup is a new covenant, not the old covenant, a new covenant. And this covenant will come by my blood. And so he takes the cup. When we take the cup, we must think about his blood. If you this morning have a medieval picture of Jesus Christ as a blonde-haired, blue-eyed, white guy on a cross with a crown with a trickle of blood coming down his head, you need to erase that forever. That's not what happened at the cross. The Jewish man, the God-man, bled. It's not a sterile environment. Blood from the garden, great drops of blood from his brow, and it got worse from there. He shed his blood, so much so that Isaiah says, this Savior was unrecognizable. This is my body. This is my blood. It is for you. So this is a procedure. This is how we got here. This is how it started. What's the point? What's the point? I mean, we're here, we're gathered for this. What's the point of all of this? Well, we need to know a couple things. One thing we need to know is this. The Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The word all there means all of us. And then it says this, the wages of sin is death. That because of the sins I have committed, and you have committed, and human history have committed, death is upon us. Here's the problem. Jesus never sinned. He was the perfect, spotless Lamb of God. And yet, he dies this death on the cross. I want you to know this morning, here's the point. Christ need not die for his sins. He had none. Jesus Christ this morning died for your sins and my sins. That's the point. Listen to Isaiah this morning. 53 verse 4. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as sheep before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. Listen to me, the point is this, that on that night, Jesus Christ truly became the Passover lamb for you and for me. So that's the procedure, that's the point, and now the question is, well, why? How does that work? What's going on here? And I want to talk to you about the word propitiation. It's a big word, but it means that it's a means of forgiveness. It's the removal of wrath by the offering of a gift. The removal of wrath by the offering of a gift. Let's be honest. In our culture, in our world today, when you talk about the death on the cross, the violence, the horror, the goriness of it all, it can be difficult. It really can be difficult. And even as believers, like, what does this mean and what's the purpose and why did this have to happen? But the truth of the matter is, the gospel message can be difficult, but we dare not apologize for it or explain it away. Propitiation means that wrath was removed. And for you and I this morning, we understand this. Jesus said, I have come not to condemn the world. And we say, yes. That's the Jesus that I love. He's the Jesus of the New Testament. He's not condemning anyone. Finish the statement. I've come not to condemn the world because the world is condemned already. Already. There is wrath against you and I from a holy, righteous God because all have sinned and we've fallen short of his glory. You and I this morning, as human beings, we're created in the image of God. We are image bearers of the Creator, which means every one of us, from the womb to the tomb, has dignity, value, and worth because we are made in the image of God. Every one of us. But as image bearers, we were given a responsibility to reflect the beauty and glory of God. That we were to receive love and fellowship from Him. And in the receiving of that vertical relationship, we were then to give it to others around us. Can you imagine truly selfless love? Like selfless. Like not trying to get anything out of it. Not using people for my own purposes. But selfless love. True fellowship and communion. As we talk face to face, there's nothing between. There's nothing hidden. There's no agenda. There's no underlying current. Could you imagine a world like that today? I long for a world like that. It's not the world we live in today. But part of the problem is, it's not Christians today either. We've done a poor job at reflecting the image of God. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All of us. We have broken trust. We were entrusted with taking that image and showing it to the world, and we have crooked behavior. And because of that, God's wrath is poured out on sin. And again, you might not like this. And I know in our culture, no one wants to talk about judgment, talk about wrath, talk about hell, because that's not where we want to go. But the gospel of Jesus Christ and the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross doesn't make any sense if there's no wrath to appease. And you say, well, God is good, God is loving, God is kind, He will just forgive. And many of you believe that. Here's the problem with that. If there was a judge in our city right now, and you had a loved one who was raped and murdered, and they were standing on trial for justice, and the judge said, I want you to know something. I'm a good and loving judge. So I just forgive you and let you go. Would anyone here be okay with that? That's not justice. That's not even love. What about the victim? What about the loss? And for a righteous, holy God, He will not stand by as sin destroys His creation. All sin will be judged by Him. And the fact is, we are in trouble. And on the cross, Christ became the propitiation. Christ appeased God's need for payment. Isaiah 53, verse 8 says this. He was taken from prison and from judgment, speaking about the servant Savior, Jesus. And who will declare His generation? For He was cut off from the land of the living, and the transgressions of my people was He stricken. And they made His grave with the wicked, but with the rich at His death, because He had done no violence, nor was any deceit in His mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise or to crush Him. He has put Him to grief. When you will make His soul an offering for sin, He shall see His seed, He shall prolong His days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in His hand. He shall see the labor of His soul and be satisfied. By His knowledge my righteous servant shall justify many, He shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide the spoil or the portion with the great, and He shall divide the spoil with the strong, because He poured out His soul unto death, and He was numbered with the transgressors, and He bore the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. This is what Jesus Christ has done. Christ's work on the cross removes the judgment of sin from sinners. We were once condemned, now we are set free by Jesus Christ. And so this morning, we come. This is the procedure. This is how it began. The point is we need a Savior. And the fact of the matter is, Christ became our propitiation. His gift satisfies the wrath of God. So we remember. This morning, here's what we need to do. We need to remember the crucifixion. Today, as you hold the bread and you hold the cup, may you see Christ crucified clearly, as seeing it for the first time. May I never lose the wonder of the cross. May I see it as like the first time, as a sinner standing lost, undone by mercy and left speechless, staring wide-eyed at the cost. May I never lose the wonder of the cross. Christian, this morning, do you remember standing as a sinner, knowing your need of a Savior, and seeing Christ crucified for you? We must remember. Number two, as we remember, we must commemorate the greatest event of all time. Do you know this morning, when Jesus Christ was suspended between heaven and earth, all of human history changed. All of it. It was changed in a moment. The curtain was torn in two. There was access to the Father, and the life of Jesus Christ, this peasant in the middle of no place, has transformed the entire world. Many of the things that we enjoy today, libraries, books, hospitals, shelters, caring for the poor, they all came from this one man, Jesus Christ. He changed the history of the world. But listen this morning, He changed my history. And He changed your history. We never stop to think, where would you be today if Christ had not intervened in your life? Honestly, would you even be here? Would you be on this planet? Would you be in bondage, addiction, in brokenness? Christ changed history. This morning we remember that there was a point when He changed our history. And we thank God for that. See Him crucified. Commemorate the greatest event of all time. He changed our history. Number three, contemplate the greatness of this mystery. Some of us think that God got a deal when he got us. I want to talk to you afterwards. God got no deal. I was meditating on this thought this week. And I was amazed at God's pursuit in my life from a child. From a child. Nothing to offer. Brokenness. Dysfunction. And yet I remember clearly at around the age of 7 this drawing. Something more. And just to see him in my life, the events that happened, the unfolding of his providence, the preaching of the word, the opening of my eyes. Why would he love me? And there is no reason other than because of him. And this morning we come and we got to stop for a second. The mystery of the fact that he loves you, he pursued you, his love and grace is lavished upon you, and we did nothing, nothing to deserve it. Nothing. That thought, as we hold this bread and hold this cup, should do something within us. The great mystery. He loves us. And in our rejection, in our running, in our rebellion, before we knew him, he pursued us. And after we knew him, in my own complacency, in my own intermittent spirituality, in my lulls of loving him, yet he still loves me. And so we remember. We see him crucified. We commemorate the greatest event of all time. We contemplate the greatest mystery that he would love us. And we come into his presence in sweet communion. My brother and sister this morning, listen to me. If we really get a hold of what took place on Mount Calvary, of why it had to happen, why it was the only way, and Jesus being willing to do that, he wasn't made. Jesus Christ came and he died for you. If we get a hold of this, I tell you something. It should change our lives. It should transform our lives. And not just on Sunday morning. It should change us. Change us. Have we been gaining ground in our Christian life? Or do we come every week in and out and nothing ever changes? I submit to you, if that's your life, if over the last year or 2 years there's been very little growth, I would say to you, you have forgotten this. You have forgotten the gospel. Therefore, you're not fruitful. Have we gained ground since our last communion? Are the corruptions growing weaker and our graces growing stronger? We all have our battles. We all have our penchant for one sin or the other. In your Christian life now, are your graces growing stronger and your corruptions growing weaker? Have we been successful at striving against our besetting sins? I joked earlier about we need 10 friendly people. But the fact of the matter is, it's not okay to be okay with no change in your life when the Spirit of God lives within you and Jesus Christ purchased you. You say, that's just the way I am. That's just the problem. Christ is a complete Savior. He's come to change you. So, how are we doing with our anger? Oh, you don't know how hard it is to stand in line at Tim Hortons. Yeah, I do. I live in Dresden. It's terrible. It's terrible. My anger, my unkindness, it blows my mind how unkind Christian people can be. I mean, worse than those who don't know Jesus. What about my bitterness, my unforgiving spirit, my lust, my greed, my self-righteousness? These are things that we ought to be actively fighting against and seeing change in our life because of this. Because of this. Christ died for you. Are we being conformed to his image? When you leave this place, is there somebody in your home, at work, or your neighborhood who would even guess that you're a believer in Christ? Who there's something about you that just shouts out Jesus? Is my love growing to all men? the one thing that makes the church such an anomaly, especially in our culture, the one thing, or the one thing that ought to be happening, is that when people look into the body of Christ, they walk into this building, and they see people from different places, different backgrounds, different cultures, different statuses, socially, economically, educationally. They look in here, and they see in this body people who actually do love each other. Like, really love each other. Like, I'm not leaving here, and at the dinner table or in the restaurant, I'm just killing everybody who is here because they're all so stupid. We all have faults, we all have failures, but we love each other. My friend, listen to me. Our discord in the church is our enemy's melody. And I go back to this table. How can I not love my brothers and sisters in Christ, who Christ loved them like he loved me and gave himself for them? Is my love growing for all men and women? And it should start here in the household of God. We should be changed. And my prayers this morning, as we take the bread and we take the cup, we don't just take it and leave. We consider what took place and transpired. Because this memorial, what we're doing here, it has a shelf life. We won't always be doing this. Some by way of death. This might be your last communion. I don't know. But there's coming a day, Christ said, do this in remembrance of me till I come. And there's coming a day when the Savior who died for us, who loved us, who gave himself, who sent his Spirit, will come back again, and he will make all of this right. He will rule, he will reign, he will be in charge, and in that day, there will be no more remembering. We will see him face to face. And in that day, everything, the loving that unlovely person, the battling against your sin, the disappointments in this world, not having enough here, the loss that we've experienced, the tragedies that we've dealt with, in that day, all of it will be worth it. It will be worth it. And so, my brother and sister, this morning, we come to remember. Remember, as you take the bread, as you take the cup, go back to that place and time that changed history forever. Not just the history of the world, but your history as well. I'll ask the men at this time to come and join me on the platform as we prepare to serve the Lord's table. Tom, Greg, let's grab the red one. Good job. Thank you. I'm going to partake in the Lord's table this morning. All those who know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you have been born again, right, by the Spirit of God through the blood of Christ. And since the time of your conversion has been baptized, we invite you to join us around the Lord's table this morning. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this morning. We thank you for the bread and the cup. We thank you for what it means and why it was done. Lord, may we simply remember, allow this truth to capture our hearts and our minds, and Lord, allow it to change us. May we leave this place this morning more in love with you and more committed to serve you. And so, I pray that your Spirit would work in our midst this morning. I pray that we would see Jesus clearly for who he is and what he's done. That we love him more, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Your brother. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul says, "For I received of the Lord that which also I deliver unto you. The Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he blessed it, he brake it." Brother Tom, would you pray for the bread this morning?
Heavenly Father, we hold in our hand a representation of the body of Jesus Christ that was broken for us. We realize that it is part of your eternal plan. It had to be this way. Jesus taught us in John 12, 24, "Unless a grain of wheat fall into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain." Father, we are sorrowful and ashamed because it was our sin that caused the suffering of Jesus Christ. At the same time, we are thankful and we rejoice that his death was not in vain, for it produced in us a new birth, a new life. Lastly, we are challenged because the cause of Christ has now become our mission, for we are to lay down our lives in service to others and to the gospel of Jesus Christ. May we take up the cross and follow him. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Jesus said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance." Eat and remember. Thank you. Paul says, Jesus, after the same manner also he took the cup when he had prayed. Brother Dennis, would you pray for the cup this morning?
Our Father, in the worthy and precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we thank thee that we can remember the blood that was shed there at the cross. We thank that there's the life of the flesh is in the blood. Mm-hmm. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. We think by faith's eye, and we look back to the cross. We've been hearing already this morning. The blood that was shed from our Savior, from his head, from that crown of thorns. The blood that was undoubtedly flowing from his face, for that beard was plucked from his face. And that cruel Roman lash, that the blood would have flowed from his back. Oh, Lord, we cannot even comprehend, but we thank you this morning for it. The blood from the cruel Roman nails, from his hands and his feet, and that spear-pierced side. Oh, Lord, what a sight, and it was for us.
Yeah.
We could not do anything for our sin, but yet he paid that price. He gave his all for us. We just thank you this morning for this cup, what it means to each and every one of us. We ask it all, and we give you thanks in his name. Amen.
Amen. Jesus said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do you as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. Drink and remember. For as oft as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. In the Gospels, we are told that after this meal, after Jesus instituted this, they sang a hymn and went out. So I'd ask you to join me in standing as we close our service with a hymn this morning. You guys can go down. Yep. You guys can go down. Yep. Good job, guys.
To see the dawn, Father.
this morning, as we leave, let me just encourage you, live in light of the cross, right? Show forth his death till he come. Start today. Start today. As we're dismissed, just a reminder, the bank is here for our folks with anniversaries, birthday parties. Sign up for the 10 friendly folks out there. Youth, adult, young adult activity in the kitchen area, please stay. And then Ruth Mormon's here. I saw Ruth earlier. Ruth, God bless you. Many of you folks know her. She's back visiting. And then Sharon, is it okay? Sharon, can I say what I was going to say earlier? Sharon Holmes is coming to present herself for membership after 500 years. All right. So in 2 weeks, we'll finally vote. She wasn't sure if she's going to stay with us or not. It's only been, what, five? 4 years. Okay. It's time. All right. So we'll vote on that in 2 weeks. God bless you for being here. Friends and guests, thank you for staying. You're dismissed.